I get several opportunities of participating in several functions, and generally, the functions are organized for the purpose of celebrating the anniversary of a success or the anniversary of a failure. But today, we have assembled here for the 10th time to celebrate the anniversary of a success which has been converted into a failure. The Supreme Court of India, 10 years before, delivered a verdict. And it was almost a century after the first police commission, which was appointed in the year 1902 and 3, Mr. Fraser. It is known as Fraser Commission. The British appointed it. The British enacted the 1861 Police Act, and they themselves, within a period of 50 years, felt that the police, which was established under a legislation enacted by themselves, needed a reform, and for that purpose, they appointed a commission. More than 100 years have passed, and we still do not know what happened to the recommendations made by Fraser Commission. Now, thereafter, there have been commissions and commissions and reports, not to be opened, not to be examined, much less to be implemented, but meant to eat dust. Possibly, we need another commission to go through the reports of commission received earlier and to examine whether the reports can really be implemented or, with the lapse of time, they have become outdated. I really admire Mr. Prakash Singh for the courage which he took up in filing a petition before the Supreme Court, having patience for 10 long years awaiting the hearing of the matter, and ultimately at the last came the judgment. He was very happy that he got the judgment from the Supreme Court, a very dynamic judgment, but he never knew that 10 years in the past, but he has yet to wait for 10 years in the future. Friends, let's come to the point. The question is one of our survival, our own survival. Everybody who's sitting here, including myself and our family members. It's a question of our survival. The person with whom we are very closely connected and wish to remain connected in our everyday activity from morning to evening and evening to morning is the police. The only guarantee of the safety of person and property is police. And howsoever we may criticize the police, but ultimate savior is the police. And therefore, each one of us has got a vital vested interest in seeing that we have a very competent, professional police which can serve the society. The simple question, if I were to put it to myself, is the choice is whether we want a people's police or politician's police. People's police or politician's police. The Indian Constitution contemplates police for the people. But the reality is that today's police is for the politicians. The police, far from being worried about the interest of the people in the society, the common man, the poor man, has got only one thing to do, and that is to serve the requirement, needs of the ruling party. Once the party changes, their allegiance and affiliations also change. They are not bothered about which party is in power. They see only who is in power. And they carry out their commands. I have sympathy with the police. The arduous duty which every policeman performs defies description. 12 hours, 14 hours, 18 hours, and even round the clock, the policeman has to serve. And the amount of power which the law gives him, therefore, just as we say, the power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely, so is the police. We can't find fault with that person. Law gives him the power, but the people expect him to become restless. There are people, the police people, many a time are posted on a duty when they don't have opportunity to meet their family members for months and years. For whom do they serve? So we have to strike a balance. We must understand what are the requirements of police, how the police can be efficient, how the police can better serve, how the police people can come out the sense of frustration which prevails in the mind of the police personnel every day in and out. We must take care of the police so that in police we find friends and not foes. Today the position is that a gentleman, a normal citizen, is mortally afraid of approaching the police. He assumes that he will be put to harassment if he goes to a police wala. There is a nexus. Criminals are very comfortable with the police. I'm sorry to say so, but then that's the reality. Friends, we have to take care of police. At the same time, we must find out what can be done that the police as an organization comes up to the expectations of citizens of a democracy. If we find that every policeman is a friend of ours, police as an organization is friendly to the people, the rate of crime would automatically come down. The reason is the criminals are not afraid of police. One who is afraid is a poor citizen like me, who always is apprehensive that if something happens, whether police will help him or not, he doesn't know. We must, therefore, as at the end somebody would sum up and we are going to pass a resolution, it's true that the power of the Supreme Court as defined by Article 141 of the Constitution is so much. You can compare one directive of Supreme Court equivalent to an act passed by the Parliament. The power which the Constitution vests in the court is the word of the Supreme Court, the law of the land. But I'm surprised why the law of land is not being implemented. I was just wondering when I was introduced with so many persons here, we have the Honorable Minister here. Once the government decides that something has to be done, it is done. I see many person present here in the audience on the dais who have held very high positions in police. Most of these recommendations may not have required a direction by the Supreme Court to be implemented. As an individual, they could have done so many things. Either they did not do it, or they failed in doing it, or they wanted to do but could not. In either case, we must open a three-pronged attack at solving our problem. One, the Supreme Court directive must be implemented. Nobody can afford to defy the directions of the Supreme Court, the mandatory directions they have to be complied with. Whether it is a state, central government, state government, nobody can say no to the directives given by the state. One. Two, at our own individual level, we should make all efforts to see that the police, Indian police, is a reformed police. And lastly, the police must also do some introspection. The police must feel that they are the police of an independent country, a country which is governed by a constitution, which is part of constitutional democracy. The police must also rise to the occasion and must realize to see what it can do at its best to serve its own citizens who look up at the police with highest expectations. Thank you very much.
At the cellular level, there is always a DNA change that precipitates cancer. In the sense of the DNA, cancer is a completely genetic disease. In India, oral cancer is the maximally prevalent form of cancer among males in India. Among females, it's cervical cancer, but breast cancer is taking over.
Watch Eureka with Dr. Partha P. Majumdar, Director, National Institute of Biomedical Genomics, only on Rajya Sabha TV.
Tales that inspire. Stories of social change. A salute to diversity. Promoting public discourse. Events that motivate. Inspiring the innovative spirit. Watch Rajya Sabha television documentaries.
Chief Justice Lahoti, Mr. Rijiju, Minister, Mr. Virappa Moili, Mr. Fali Nariman, Maya Daruwala, my colleague Ramachandran, and Mr. Praveen Swami, and very distinguished members among the audience, ladies, gentlemen, and friends. First of all, I thank you for responding to our invitation and turning up in such good numbers to grace this occasion. We decided to assemble today because on the 22nd of September we completed 10 years of Supreme Court judgment on police reforms. Actually, it took 20 years, 10 years for the public interest litigation, another 10 years for monitoring. 20 years is a small time in the history of a nation, but 20 years for a matter to pend before the Supreme Court, I think that's something we need to worry about. The PIL took 10 years, that is understandable. Cases do take long time. But why should it have taken 10 years to ensure implementation of that judgment? That is the big question. The judgment was to be implemented according to the original order by the end of 2006. Subsequently, when some of the states expressed difficulties, the time limit was extended to March 31, 2007. But the matter continues to drag on. And some of the states which have been very clever, I repeat the word clever, they passed acts in great hurry. Normally one would have expected that these acts are being passed in compliance of the Supreme Court's directions. But actually, in the judgment, there was a proviso that these directions will hold good till such time as the central and the state governments pass their own legislation on the subject. Now, they picked up this particular proviso and ignored the rest of the judgment. They saw in this proviso an escape clause that these directions would apply only till such time as the state and the central governments pass their legislation on the subject. So they said, we passed the legislation, and now we are beyond the purview of the Supreme Court. And the laws which they passed legitimized the status quo. In some cases, it was so regressive. They say about Bihar, they say it was so regressive that it takes you back not to the British days, but to the East India Company days. So 17 states have passed laws purportedly in compliance of Supreme Court's directions, but actually violating the letter and the spirit of the court's order. The remaining states passed executive orders. One thought those would be in better compliance, but even those either dilute or modify or amend in some form or the other, they subvert the Supreme Court's directions. And at the end of 10 years of monitoring, when I ask myself, have we improved after the Supreme Court judgment? Is the police more people friendly? Are we upholding the rule of law as we are supposed to be doing? I'm sorry to say that the answer is an emphatic no. On the contrary, what disappoints me is that probably the graph has gone further down and there is further deterioration in the quality of policing that we are having in the country. I could give many instances, but I'll restrict myself to just one or two. What happened in Haryana was a complete collapse of the administration and the police structure. I had read only in the books that the state would wither away one day, in the Marxist books. But I saw in Haryana for 2 days there was nothing like government. And rampaging crowds were destroying public and private property at will and assaulting people whom they thought were not well disposed towards them. Now, are we going to... My worry is that a similar collapse can happen in other states also. Because there are disturbing similarities in the power structures and equations that existed in Haryana and that exist in some other states also. The possibility of a similar collapse in some other states on the eve of elections can never be ruled out. It's terrible that during the last 10 years so much happened. You see, when we presented before the Supreme Court that the states are not complying, the probably courts were not inclined to trust me, and they said, no, we will appoint a committee to go into what is the level of compliance. So they appointed a Justice Thomas committee in 2008, and in 2010, they came up with a report expressing, to quote their words, dismay over the total indifference, quote unquote, dismay over the total indifference of the states to complying with the Supreme Court's directions. That report was given in 2010. In 2012, we had another committee headed by Justice J.S. Verma. The context was entirely different. That was constituted in the wake of Nirbhaya Kand. And the committee's mandate was also different. But the committee devoted one full chapter, I think about 20 pages, to police reforms. And they very clearly said that if crimes under women, and crimes generally are to be brought under control, then the directions given by the Supreme Court in Union of India versus Prakash Singh have to be implemented. They very clearly said that there are systemic problems in policing and the answer lies in implementing the Supreme Court judgment. That was said in 2013. So 2010, Justice Thomas said something, 2013, Justice Verma said, but all this had no impact on the state governments. And some of the states were so brazen in their defiance of the Supreme Court orders. In my own state of Uttar Pradesh, they appointed DGPs for 1 month and 2 months and 3 months and 6 months. We went to the Supreme Court, look, my lord, this is what is happening. But the Supreme Court was also not inclined to issue any contempt notice even on such a brazen defiance of its own directions. The question that I have, which are agitating in my mind are, number one, if the Supreme Court issues direction, a set of directions, it has a certain sanctity about it. It is a direction coming from the highest court of the land. Can any individual organization or state defy those directions and get away with it? This is my big question. And if they can get away with it, which seems to be the impression in the states currently, then I'm afraid that the directions of the Supreme Court would be treated with contempt by people, by organizations, or by states which think that they can afford to do it and get away with it. That would lead to breakdown of the constitutional machinery. Question number two. Some states legislated, and the laws which they enacted were blatantly in violation of the Supreme Court directions. Now, should these states be allowed to get away with laws which violate the letter and the spirit of the court's directions just because you have the power to enact a law? Can you enact a law in defiance, perpetually in defiance, in a malafide manner, defying the directions of the court? Should those acts not be declared ultra vires of the Constitution? This is the second question I have. Now, these things are agitating my mind, and we are at a very critical juncture. We are pursuing this matter of police reforms not for the glory of the police. Let it be said very clearly, not for the glory of the police. This is being pursued in the interest of improving governance, in the interest of having better law and order, in the interest of upholding human rights of citizens, in the interest of having rule of law in the country. That is the objective. And not for the glory of the police, as some people are inclined to think. There's another point. I strongly feel that if we do not address this issue of police reforms, the democratic structure may collapse one day. As it is, the number of people with questionable background, their percentage is going up in the parliament every successive election. According to the Association of Democratic Reforms, in 2004 it was 24%. This jumped to 30% in 2009 election, and further went up to 34% in 2014. So the number of people with questionable background in parliament is gradually going up. Now, the society has to make up its mind. You want us to salute the mafia, you want us to salute people with criminal background, or you want us to uphold the rule of law. Let the society decide this. You see, alongside another disturbing development, the nexus about which Vora Committee talked in 1993, that nexus is becoming very powerful, very powerful. And if you want any proof, I could get any amount of it, but the latest was the manner in which Shahabuddin was released on bail. It's the power of the nexus which brought that mafia outside the jail. So this nexus is also becoming very, very powerful. The total scenario is very grim and serious. And if we do not wake up to the importance, the relevance, and the urgency of police reforms, we could be heading for very bad times. This, the last point, we are very proud of the economic progress which this country is making, and rightly so. But this economic structure needs solid foundations of good law and order. If you don't have good law and order, you can't have economic progress. Nobody is going to invest his millions in an area where the returns are not assured and where the security of the management is not guaranteed. Nobody is going to invest. I would like to see what, I mean, how much big ticket investment Haryana gets after the latest series of violent incidents which ravaged Haryana during February. Nobody is going to invest. So what is at stake is not only good policing, but a healthy democracy is at stake, and sound economic progress or sustained momentum of economic progress is at stake. Thank you very much.